Hey guys, this is Brian Mounts. I run turfmechanic.com and this channel, and today I'm coming to you with a video where I'm not going to teach you anything at all. Instead, I want to show you about my yard. I'm going to show you my yard, where it stands right now. It's, what is it, July 12th? It's almost late. It's basically mid-July 2021. I've received a number of comments over the past year, and they're coming in more and more frequency, greater frequency, having to do with the origins of my yard. How is my yard the way that it is? Why do I have such a nice looking yard, but such obvious thatch level? I've had a number of people ask about my location, where I live, the climate. I keep a green yard in what appears to be the desert, as you can see behind me. There's the yard back there. We garden. I've literally had comments about people saying, how are you talking about gardening stuff? You don't have a garden. I have 9 garden beds back there. So now last year I had like 5. But still, I've got a lot of stuff going on around here and I don't talk about it too much. So I wanted to kind of show you the yard, talk to you about where this yard came from and where it's going, or at least my plan for the foreseeable future. As I zoom out here, this is what I affectionately call my hill yard. My hill yard is brown. I've watered it one single time this year. We're in drought. Everyone alive knows the droughts and heat waves are happening on the West Coast. We are in Southeast Oregon and it is no different here. Now, ordinarily I have watered this and I have maintained it with a lawnmower that you see right there. This year, I haven't been watering it. The reason for that is because I have not prepared the soil whatsoever to grow grass. I haven't killed off weeds. I haven't put down weed preventers. I haven't fertilized up here. I haven't done anything. So if I'm watering the lawn up here, or the grass, or the foliage, you know, whatever you want to call this, if I'm watering this up here, then it's going to be quite wasteful. Not to mention the fact that I don't have turf grass up here. There's maybe a chunk of turf grass right over here from some spot seeding that I did like 3 years ago. It's actually a Kentucky 31 tall fescue. You can't even tell, it just blends in. So this little spot right here, this little kind of triangle, is Kentucky 31 tall fescue. Cut low, it just blends into the natural field grasses that you see up here, the field grasses and weeds. Now up here, you'll also see things like this. I've done some, I'm gonna call it leveling. It's not really leveling, but these are cores. Those are lawn cores that I pulled when I did mechanical aeration down on my main lawn a few months ago, back in March. I saved the cores, I raked them all up, and I brought them up here into low spots to kind of level it out. So when I bring the lawnmower over here, I can actually bring it down one notch more and scalp the lawn a little bit less, or scalp the surface area, because I wouldn't call that a lawn. Anyway, we're in drought conditions, so I'm not watering up here. At some point, I'll probably start tending to the soil, fertilizing, killing off or preventing weeds and things like that, putting some seed down, possibly even this fall, but it's not in my immediate plan. When we did move into this house 4.5 years ago, none of this that you see here existed. So all of that, there was actually a tree right here that I manually pulled out of the ground. I literally dug it out, dug the roots out and everything. There was 2 garden beds. So I dug the tree out and I put these extra garden beds in. We call them beds 3 and 4. So right now we've got a hoop house over the top of this one because the bird, these are all basically greens, and then over here we have carrots. The birds really go to town on the greens, so we cover it up. Over there we've got some other cold season crops, cabbages and cauliflowers and whatnot, and they do better when they're under that the shade of that cloth over there, because right now it's, I mean, we're like 95 degrees. We have been for like 2.5 weeks now. So anyway, I pulled the tree out and these 2 beds I installed. I also, we've had chickens for the better part of a decade, and I ended up just building this chicken coop. So instead of buying a coop, we just thought it would be nice to build something nice, big, and far more permanent. So here I can just walk in without bumping my head. I've literally got, there's some chickens down there hiding from the heat underneath. But yeah, this thing is insulated very thick. We've got foam insulation in the middle. This is actually a little trap door that will slide up and down. So if we want to trap them in there, we can. I am not a carpenter, nor do I really have background in carpentry. I suppose my grandfather and his dad did a lot of carpentry and work like that, so I do enjoy it. But yeah, so here's the coop. I need to clean this out and add some fluff. But the chickens do really well in here, and we gave them this nice run. And I mean, see, I'm standing upright just walking around. This is why we built it like this. They have plenty of space, and I can walk around in here just fine dealing with them. In terms of the lawn is what most of you guys that subscribe to this channel care about. So the hill yard is really rustic. Now, it used to look really, really overgrown brush. And of course, I've cut it back, and I've made a couple videos about repairing a lawn without doing anything other than mowing and watering. And I do believe that over the course of a few more years, if I just kept on doing that up here, if I watered regularly and continued to do it, it would just get better and better and better. This year, however, the drought is forcing my hand. It doesn't seem reasonable to keep watering this up here. Now, this spring, mostly in the month of June, and even really in the last like week or so, I have upgraded our garden. So I put in this, I've replaced our side garden bed here. We don't have anything planted in it yet, and I still need some more extra soil, but this is gonna be our pollinator bed. So we're gonna put a lot of flowers and pollinator stuff in here. This used to be exposed to the deer, and of course, if we planted anything in there, then the deer would just eat it. So over the past like week and a half or so in the summer, early summer 2021, I have put it on the inside of the fence. I've also upgraded the fence to this nice pressure treated stuff and made it a little bit bigger. So now it's a much more sturdy wall all the way around, and we have far more space. This used to be a path. In fact, I have a video a few months ago where I told my lawn plans for 2021, and I showed this path. This is the path that goes to the back of the chicken coop, and it was just overgrown weeds and unkempt. Nothing about it looked good at all. And I said I loved my wife and she wanted more garden beds, so I was going to build her garden bed. So there you go. This is what a man does when he loves his wife. Extended the wall out and all the way back to the end of the coop. And now we have extra beds here. So we have four extra beds. We got the extra one here. A little bit later this year, I'm gonna add an extra bed back there, kind of back there. So we'll round it out. We'll have 10 solid beds going into the fall. Also here in spring of 2021, I took this tiny little area. There's my recorder right there. This is how the magic is done in terms of audio recording. This tiny little area right here used to be just an enormous patch of weeds and dandelions. And the reason for that is 3.5 years ago, we had a landscaping company come in here and dig up. This was basically like from our house, came out to about there, and then it started sloping down and away from the house. So it was just an immediate drop off on a hill. And obviously we are on hills here. From the house, it just dropped off, especially as we go way over there. It dropped off quick and fast and steep. So we had a landscaper come in and they put these boulders right here. You see the boulder? They saved, this was the grade of our tree was way down there. It's about a couple feet down. We saved the tree and then we put in these boulders here. Of course, I'll have to do some weed and foliage cleanup here, but these boulders, right here, this is about a 3-foot drop to the ground. You can see the T-post there. And as we go back this way, there's our grapevine, which is hard to grow where we live, but it's thriving. We got grapes growing on there and everything. Beautiful. Come back over here, our rock wall splits. There's a lower tier down there and then one up here. The heavy machinery to bring in these rocks, we're literally talking, it's 60 tons of rocks. It took multiple bulldozer full loads of rocks to bring this wall up and give us the flat lawn that you see in all of my videos. Weeds. I'm not perfect. I'm not even close to perfect. This wall right here, see where I'm at here? I'm on the side yard now. As we look down, this wall right here is about maybe 3 to 4 feet down to the level there. And then that wall is another 3 to 4 feet down to the bottom. Grand total from where I'm standing right now to the base down there, we're up probably about 8 feet or more. So as you can tell, or as you can surmise, the landscaper that brought in all of these rocks and stones and whatnot literally lifted the ground from where it was naturally to where it is now. So we had a lot of fill dirt come in. So a number of comments have come in over the years, or over the months really, saying it looks like you just had sod put down right on top of your old lawn. Well, that's not really the case. We had this whole area, everything, all of my flat lawn was ripped up, completely ripped up, bulldozed over with heavy machinery for about 3 weeks straight. A new topsoil was brought, a new fill dirt was brought in to kind of bring the ground up to level. And then we had topsoil put in, like well-made topsoil, made sourced locally here, brought in, put down on top of that. And then the sod was placed on top of that. Long story short, since around April 2018, I really got myself into the lawn care game simply because I spent so much money building a yard. When you spend that much money building a yard from scratch, I don't know, you just care about it more, I guess. I don't know, you buy a house, you move in, you care about the house. Once you spend the money on the yard, making it from scratch, you care about it. So you start to learn a lot. I started learning a lot. Like lots of people out there, I started learning from Alan Hain, the lawn care nut. I didn't move on. I still learn from him. I still watch his material and others too. You know, I mean, I'm not the only guy around. There's a lot of good people out there, a lot of good creators out there that have a lot of good quality information that you can learn from. But this is who I am. I'm a teacher. I like understanding how things work. So I started working on my lawn, and the best way that I could figure out how to do that was to start documenting the process. I started a website, and it has evolved into me teaching the process to other people. Now, when that lawn was put into place back in spring of 2018, I didn't really know very much about lawn care at the time, and I trusted my landscaper to set up the sprinkler system. And quite honestly, in retrospect, the landscaper that put in our irrigation system and our retaining wall and fill dirt and rock and yard and sod and all that, he did a great job. The thing is, I didn't know how to adjust the sprinkler system after a period of time passed. So the sod goes in. Once you put sod in, you really need to water it frequently, like all the time, to really get the stuff to establish. But as time passes, you need to start dialing back the frequency and dialing up the quantity. What I should have done after a few weeks is start moving to a really deep cycle of watering infrequently, and I just never made that transition in 2018. So what happened? I got a nice thick layer of thatch that formed. Now, back also at that time, I cut my grass a lot taller, and I couldn't really tell so much. As my kids started growing, started realizing that we were losing toys in tall cut grass all the time. And I got lots of little guys. We got four little kids here. My biggest little kid is 10. So I guess he's not so little anymore. But we were tired of losing toys, and I'd run the mower over it and I'd hit toys because I couldn't even see it there. So I started cutting my grass a little bit shorter. So anyway, a thatch-filled lawn that had been growing tall for a year and a half to 2 years, and then I started cutting it shorter. It's made it easier for us to spend time in the lawn, but it's been a hard process fixing the lawn. So over the past year and a half, because really if you go back to April of 2020 when I started this YouTube channel, you could still see a lot of the problems, obvious problems that I had in my lawn, which are still present today, but much less so. So, I mean, we're getting down to like little things like paver stones. I've had to pick up every paver stone, dig them out, and put them deeper, because as you cut the grass lower, if any kind of stone is sticking up, you're more likely to hit it. And I did that. I had to redo sprinkler heads that were set too high. So as you bring mowers down, I started hitting sprinkler heads. So I've had to do that. Of course, I've been doing the thatch remediation, and I've been doing a lot of biostimulants to push root development under the thatch layer and as deep as possible. I've been enjoying my time here in the lawn, but there's definitely things that I still need to work on. And I'm looking forward to the fall, because the fall truly is the best time for cold season lawns like mine. That's the best time to do everything when it comes to dethatching and aerating and fertilizing and overseeding and starting new lawn spaces. All of that stuff is much easier to do all of those things in the fall. Now around here, because I'm high elevation, cold season climate here, that stuff gets done earlier in the season than it does everywhere else. Around here, we really start cooling off pretty early in the fall. So overseeding and seeding projects tend to happen for me in August. So I am planning on doing a little bit of seeding this August. I haven't decided if I'm going to take another section of my hill yard and turn it into grass. I mean, you can see how nice it is here. And then it's really nice here. I'm going to overseed this with Kentucky bluegrass to kind of blend it. I mean, you could tell the difference. I mean, enormous difference. Keeping the lawn looking nice is something that I want. So getting a few more extra square foot here and there sounds great to me. It's just a matter of, do I want to put in the work? What I do want to do is around here to the left. This is something that I mentioned in my lawn goals video back in end of March or 1st of April, whenever it was that I published that. This section of the lawn over here, kind of the front, especially in the fall, winter, and spring, this whole area is almost always shaded. I mean, even now, I mean, it is very, very shady. I had a failed dormant seeding project here because I accidentally sprayed and washed away all of the seed with a hose in the middle of January. I have a video where I dormant seeded there in the end of November, 1st of December, and then literally in January, I accidentally took the hose to it on a warm day and washed everything away. So this is something I want to fix, but honestly, I want to fix the whole thing here. Not that this looks bad, but we're tired of having this gravel right around in here. So what I would like to do is pull this gravel out right here and mix in a very dense seeding of creeping red fescue, which is a fine fescue that's going to do very well in the shade. And our sprinkler system does not extend that way. So a creeping red fescue is going to do well in the shade, and it's not going to require the same amount of water as a perennial rye or Kentucky bluegrass mix. So I feel like this is a great section, shady, cool season, low water section that would be perfect for fine fescue. If I can figure out a way to do it with the time that I have available, I'm going to try to get that done and document it here on the channel. I'm going to continue making pots of grass. It looks like I have successfully killed my first pot right there, my Kentucky 31. I have some videos about this, handful of videos about this where I featured it throughout 2020. Back in June, we got into the upper 90s and I neglected it for a few days too long, and I really just kind of killed it. It just died off. Now, Kentucky 31 and turf type tall fescue, they do well in drought conditions, but the thing is, these guys are in pots. In a proper lawn setting, the roots are able to go deeper and deal with stresses a lot better than they are in pots. So I've got a couple green blades in there, but I don't think it's coming back at this point. I darn near did the same thing to the perennial rye, kind of killed off the middle. I'm hopeful that when the heat subsides, we get back into the 70s and 80s, and I can put this thing back in the full sun, it's going to come back. But interestingly enough, all of my fine fescues, even though they're cold season grasses, look great. Those are, let's see, that's one, that's two. Here's my other fine fescues over here. Another fine. They look fantastic. And that's because they're in full shade. It's the only place that I can keep them at 100 degree heat. All of the others are struggling because it's in full shade and it's hot, but these are doing great. Interesting. Everything about that is interesting to me. Anyway, I'm going to continue doing these pots because I think they're great learning experiments. Over here, I'll have some videos coming out sprinkled in over July and August having to do with warm season grass types. I've got my small pot of centipede grass, which is apparently very, very difficult to grow in lawn settings and in pots. This is zoysia. This has been a little bit easier than the centipede. And I got Bermuda grass. This is almost hands off. This is like easy, dare I say easy. But there's the Bermuda. So videos will be coming out about those. There's always things to do. There's always things that even those of us lawn care crazies neglect. I have fully neglected year after year after year this area of my retaining wall. I haven't weeded it. I haven't put down pre-emergence. I got weeds coming up here. They drop their seeds on the ground and then I got to deal with that. I got a cherry tree here, which I never protected from the birds. So we lost all the cherries. In any event, I hope to be better in the future at tending to this wall and just making it look its best. Maybe one of these days you'll be able to see it looking its best. I haven't even seen it looking its best. The fence line is something that I always am aware of and I never have time to deal with. So at some point I have to pull out these pavers and rip out all of the root systems and put down some product to get stuff to stop growing back there because they grow and then they seed and then more weeds come. I've got other issues that largely go unnoticed on the channel, but I'll happily show you now. This right here is an example. This is a shrub. It's like a sucker of a shrub. I've got one there. I've got one there. And they are literally through the yard. They're everywhere in the yard. Let's see. Look at this right here. See that? That's a little sucker of the exact same shrub. They share a root system. So the root system grows kind of through these underground rhizomes and it's all connected. There used to be a shrub here that was larger than this tree. We cut it down and everything green that you see is that shrub trying to come back. So I have to go down a couple times a year and cut it back, but it's always trying to come into the lawn. And I have yet to figure out a good way of dealing with that. This is who I am. This is my yard as of today. These are my thoughts going forward. It's kind of the history of where my yard started and came from. I hope you find it interesting. And I hope that you stick around through the rest of the summer season going into the fall and follow my progress as I continue to make this yard the best it possibly can be. And as I continue to teach you little things here and there as best as I can. Take a look in the description below. I've got a new YouTube channel dedicated to lawn care topics in short form format. So if you're interested in learning stuff about the lawn without all of this banter and talk that I do, go ahead and take a look at that. Thank you very much for watching this deep into the video, and I hope to see you in other videos down the road.